so apparently cruel and apparently reflects so poorly on the character of God. A loving God, and here it says, it pleased the Lord to bruise Jesus. Like he got pleasure out of the death of Jesus. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. He, the Father, has put him, the Son, to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Think about that phrase, friends. Think about that verse.
Jesus said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son." So,
hope you've been thinking about that question I asked you before the songs. What I want to do with you today is read through Isaiah chapter 53. As we celebrate communion, we go back those 2,000 years, roughly speaking, to the time when our Lord and our Master, the one we've claimed as our personal Savior, surrendered his life in a violent and substitutionary death. And Isaiah chapter 53, like few other chapters in Scripture, do such a great job of portraying that experience. And so I really want to let Scripture do most of the talking today. I don't plan to say too much, maybe a comment or two on certain of the verses. But I want you to just read through this passage with me meditatively, thoughtfully, look at it in your own Bibles, and just try and picture these scenes. Walk with the prophet Isaiah as he was shown in vision these things that he wrote down for our benefit. He wrote them having not yet seen the day of Christ. He wrote them looking forward some, 600 odd years, 600 and something years. And yet we need it as much today because we were not there in person some 2,000 years ago when this was fulfilled. And so just as the prophet Isaiah did not live to see the day in person, neither have you and I seen that day in person. He, like us, had to look at the day through the eyes of faith and through the revelation of the prophecy. And so that's really what I want to share with you this morning. Let's bow our heads for a brief word of prayer. Heavenly Father, will you give to us your guidance, your direction? Will you quicken our imaginations, Lord, so often dumbed down and anesthetized by the media industry, by television and all the rest? Will you bring it to life as we contemplate these words of Scripture? For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Prophet starts with a question. Who has believed our report? Has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Who amongst us today have believed? Who amongst us have accepted the report? And this is the report. For Jesus, for he shall grow up before him. All capitalized, right? For he, Jesus, shall grow up before him, the Father, God the Father, as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. I see their innocence. I see their vulnerability. both the Father and the Son took an infinite risk in coming the way he did. He has no form or comeliness. And when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire. That is to say, he looked like us. No advantages, no kingly or stately bearing, no magic powers, no magic wand, like one of us. Didn't stand out of the crowd, just blended right in. So authentic was his human nature. He is despised and rejected by men. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. He didn't live the high life. He didn't enjoy the palaces of the kings. He didn't have a life of ease. He had the worst of the raw deal. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. The ones he came to save, his own. When he was rejected, when he was despised, at least when you've gone through a tough time, you've always had friends, right? Those who esteem you, those who regard you, and they will encourage you. But there was no one to encourage him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. And yet, despite that, we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. This makes sense when you read Galatians, by the way, because Paul makes a point of quoting from Moses, where it states that the one who is hung upon a tree is cursed of God. We looked at him and we said, he is cursed. And we didn't grasp that it was us who was cursed and he was carrying our curse. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. The only way you and I could have peace, the only way that you and I can talk about a peace that surpasses understanding, the only way that you and I can say, you know what, my burden has been rolled off my shoulders, is because he paid the price. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, we are healed. And you know what those stripes are, right? The night of his crucifixion, the night before his crucifixion, taken out to the praetorium, strapped down, hands and feet, in a standing position, so that he could not run, not that he would. And then the soldier took that leather whip, you know, cat of nine tails, strands of leather with pieces of iron and bone strapped into it, and he whipped it. 40 minus one. And every time those lashes went past, they cut stripes into his back. I don't know how many of you have had a hiding. I know that's very politically incorrect in New Zealand. But he got the hiding of his life. No, he got the hiding of our life. His stripes, etched into his back by those little pieces of bone and iron, as the executioner would pull that whip back and it would bite in and take chunks of flesh out. And then jump forward a few hours and realize that he's nailed to a cross with his back up against that rough pole. By his stripes, we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to our own way. Couldn't care less, doing our own thing. this picture of him suffering, the description is given through the prophet that we wouldn't grasp what was happening. We would just be going on like normal, not understanding the significance, not appreciating what was being done. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, and yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. But it takes so little to get my mouth going. Man, just a bad traffic day, or someone failing to greet me at church on a Sabbath morning, or maybe even something that is vaguely serious. It doesn't take me much to get my mouth going, either about a brother or a sister, whether in complaint or whether in gossip. And here he is, not suffering for his own, but he keeps his mouth shut. I'm humbled by that. I'm humbled by that. That is a rebuke. That is a rebuke to me, to us. Something today as we participate in communion, that we can commit to God for forgiveness and for change. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was stricken. After it all, it's interesting when you cross-reference this with Daniel chapter 9, verse 26. You know, the 70-week prophecy. And it says, he shall be cut off, but not for himself. He wasn't dying for him. He would die an unselfish death. He would die for the other. And Isaiah picks that up here in chapter 53, verse 8. Was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was stricken. And they made his grave with the wicked, crucified between two thieves, indicating that he was seen as a criminal. But with the rich in his death, remember Joseph of Arimathea, right? Buried in that rich man's tomb. Because he had done no violence, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And then the verse I asked you to think about. Yet, after all that's been said, after the gruesome picture that's painted in your mind, of which it's probably what I've said here is not even a tenth of what he endured, yet after all that's been said, as horrible, as horrific as that was, then comes this line. Yet it pleased the Lord, it pleased him to bruise him. It pleased God to do all the stuff we described to him. It pleased him that he sent him to live a life of rejection, to live a life of persecution. It pleased him that he was whipped to the point of death. It pleased the Father that on the cross, he hung there grasping for air. It pleased the Father that everyone scattered and abandoned him. It pleased the Father that even the Father would turn his back on him and reject him. How does that verse fit in with your picture of God? It pleased him. And then it says, he, the Father, has put him, the Son, to grief. I got an email once, maybe you've received it, you know how these things go, about a story about a I don't need to repeat all that. The bottom line of the story was that someone came along and redeemed these birds, and the idea behind the story was that our lives were redeemed from the enemy of souls, from the devil who caged us. And when I read that, I realized that is not the teaching of Scripture. It was not Satan who killed Jesus. It was the Father. How do you get that around your head? I mean, we talk about him as the Savior, right? We talk about him as, and he, according to this, he, the Father, put the Son to grief. Was the devil there? Was the devil making it worse? Of course he was. But at the end of the day, who is the debt for sin owed to? Is it owed to the devil? Have we sinned against Satan? No. Sin is against God. He is the party who is offended. The devil is the instigator. The devil is the one that got the whole ball rolling. The devil is the one who tempts. The devil is the one who insinuates at times. But nevertheless, when we sin, the psalmist writes in Psalm 51, against thee, speaking to God, against thee and thee only have I sinned. So who is it that punished Jesus on the cross? The devil or the Father? To whom was the debt owed? To Satan or to the Father? To God. When you see the picture of Jesus on the cross, you see God's hatred for sin poured out on him. You see the Father punishing his Son to the point of death. And if you are a parent, you can only begin to understand what that must have done to the heart of the Father. And yet, Scripture says, I come back to this, it pleased him. Is God vengeful? Does he sit up in heaven just looking for who he can zap today? Some of us think about God that way, right? That his great goal in life, I grew up thinking this, is to make life as unpleasant and as unenjoyable as possible. That he's just waiting for you to step out of line. And you might be mistaken to get that idea from this text. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. He, the Father, has put him, the Son, to grief. But it goes on from there. And when you read the rest, you understand why it pleased him. When you make his soul an offering for sin, when you, the Father, make his soul, the Son, an offering for sin, when the Father makes him an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall see his seed. From the death of the one would come a harvest of humanity for eternity. He shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Scripture tells us, you know this verse, where the Lord says, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. What is the Lord's pleasure? To forgive, to save. And the only way he could do it was if the price was paid through the death of his own Son, Jesus. When you stand at the cross, you see the wrath of God, the anger of God, poured out upon himself. Not out upon another. That's why no angel could substitute. No third party could come in. He had to take it upon himself. And it pleased him not because of the punishment. It pleased him because of the ultimate result. In other words, he looks at you and he says, you are of such value. You are so special to me that when I see what happens to my Son at the cross, as horrific as it is, to which you and I cannot even comprehend the full length and breadth of that horrificness, when I see what has happened to my own Son on the cross, when I had to do that to him, when my hand was forced to either cast you aside or I had to do this to my own Son, it pleases me to do that to him. That's how precious you are to me. I would consider it a pleasure. pleasure to do that to him. That's how bad I want you in the kingdom with me. That's how much I love you. The love of God illustrated by the horrificness of the nature of his death, and it pleased him because you will be with him in heaven. He shall see the labor of his soul and shall be satisfied. Powerful verse. When you get to heaven and you're walking through those pearly gates, he's not going to say, well, I'm glad you're here, but if I had to do it all over again, I probably wouldn't because the suffering was so intense. It says that even from Jesus' perspective, not only did it please the Father, but it says that even from Jesus' perspective, who endured it and survived the cross through the resurrection, when you get to heaven one day, it says his soul will be satisfied. That the measure of his suffering cannot compare with the joy and the pleasure of having you with him for all of eternity. By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many, and made intercession. Friends, as we wash one another's feet, let these thoughts of how the Master and his Father were pleased by the cross, looking forward to the day you accepted him, looking forward to the day he comes to fetch you again. As we eat that bread, as we drink that pure grape juice, understand the price that was paid and know thereby how much he has loved you and appreciated you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, what a price has been paid for our redemption. What greater argument could we have in favor of the love of God for each of us? Teach us to appreciate. Write it upon our hearts and our minds. And Lord, will you teach us to